left, goes right through, puts on the step again. Oh, no, Freddie, that was magnificent stuff.
Welcome back to another edition of the Advatange Line, the podcast where we talk about everything rugby league. And this week, it's not only the Grand Final edition, we've got a very, very special guest. Of course, before I get to our special guest, we've got the usual motley crew. Of course, Matt Fisk over there in Sydney. Fisky, how are you today?
Oh, mate, I'm cock-a-hoop. Grand Final week, and I've got two West Tigers legends on the podcast today, mate. So I couldn't be happier.
Okay, Carl, No, you're not one of those legends, but Carl, Tiley, you're also back. How are you?
Just a legend. Thanks to my name. Thanks, Paul. Yeah, I'm good. I'm good. Pumped for a big show. Pumped for the Grand Final. Can't wait for the weekend.
Excellent. Blake Ashford back again, all the way from Papamoa. Probably the best place to be in New Zealand at the moment. Blake, how are you?
Good, mate. The sun's shining. Beach is looking good. I just want to give you a rap, mate. You're a big game player. You know, usually we get the run sheet 5 minutes before the show. Today it was about 3 hours. So, mate, good job. Big game player, GF. You're on it today.
Oh, gee. Just call me Benji. I make you look good, big guy.
It's a bit of a springing pool step today. Maybe he's been hanging out with Cheese up on the
golf course. Our special guest, and we're very grateful to have him too, 2003 Grand Finalist winner. With the Penrith Panthers, Scottie Sattler. Scott, how are you?
I'm good, guys. Thanks for having me on. Very exciting week.
Can you just tell us, where are you calling us from?
I'm on the Gold Coast. So we're in a pretty good zone here on the Gold Coast. Here in southeast Queensland has been pretty free for a long time now when it comes to the COVID protocols. And although the last 48 hours, there's been a couple of cases in Queensland, we're sort of sitting back with bated breath to see what happens with accessibility this week to the community.
With everything that's going on, you got tickets to the Grand Final?
I'm calling the Grand Final for SC.
Oh, here we go.
On Sunday, so fingers crossed I'm allowed to attend.
Oh, well, fingers crossed big time. I'm sure everything will turn out okay in the end. I think we should probably start the show, and I know that Fisky's just at the bit there, he just wants to get straight stuck into talking to you about your career. But I guess could we just start a wee bit before that? You were born in New South Wales, grew up on the Gold Coast. Your dad played rugby league. In fact, he won multiple premierships with the Bunnies. But you were probably born right towards the end of his playing career. Do you remember anything about his career, or do you actually talk to him about it?
Yeah, I've basically been brought up in dressing sheds. I was conceived in the Redfern Oval dressing shed. So we moved to Dad's final year at South Sydney was 72. I was born in December 71. And so we moved up to Queensland at the end of 1972. The Queensland Rugby League back then, they purchased my dad and the great Tommy Bishop to move to Queensland, try and strengthen the Queensland competition. So we had 3 years in Brisbane. And I vaguely remember a couple of things at Lang Park, not him playing, but just things about Lang Park. But then after he retired, basically we grew up owning and living in the pubs that we owned. So we lived up on top of every pub that we owned. Last count, there was about 12 or 13 pubs. So pretty colourful upbringing for myself and my sister. But I can really vividly remember, yeah, every Sunday my dad would take me to Lang Park for the match of the round, which was a lot of times with South Magpies, who was coached by his former teammate Bobby McCarthy. So I grew up loving South Sydney my whole life, putting my dad's jerseys on and playing imaginary games on my knees, and I was the great Bob Fulton, Bob McCarthy I should say, every time I played. And then grew up idolising the Brisbane Rugby League teams, the South Magpies, which yeah, Gary Belcher and Malman Ingram, Peter Jackson and all those sorts of players, Billy Johnston playing there. So, you know, it's fair to say that I was brainwashed really early as a kid as a South Sydney fan, and also in being involved in rugby league. I can recall numerous multiple times as a kid just sitting in a dressing shed with a can of lemonade and a and a bucket of chips or something just after a game, just while Dad was talking to people. So, yeah, it's sort of my second home, the dressing sheds.
Well, you're rugby league through and through, and it wouldn't surprise me if your dad had to kick Fisky out a number of those pubs that you guys ran back in the day.
Give me a break, Paul. I'm old. I'm not that old.
Fisky, you want to ask Scott a few questions?
Yeah, mate, I'd love to. Look, I know it's going to be the first question you get asked all the time, and I actually got another one about West Tigers, but I'll start with this. How did your life change after that tackle in 2003? Like, I still remember it like yesterday. Bit of a Kiwi connection because Todd Skinny Byrne ended up playing for the Warriors for a few years. How did your life change after that? That was just brilliant. I'll never forget it.
I got invited to a lot more functions. I know that. but you know what? It I suppose it changed my life in a sense that it probably made my career look a lot better than what it actually was. You know, I've played over 200 NRL games, which I'm very, very proud of. I when I started playing first grade, I just wanted to try and – I wanted to get 75 games. And so to be able to play 200, I was really proud of that. You know, I worked really hard off the field to try and sap every little bit of talent that I had out of my body. You know, I was never going to be a, you know, Bradley Clyde or someone like that who played in the same position. So I had to work really hard to – and outside of that, I had to work really hard with – you know, with the surname as well, you know, try and break that mold. So so when that tackle occurred, how did it change my life? I suppose what it did do, it probably put into context a father and son winning premierships, which very rarely fathers and sons do. But the outside of that, a father and son having a what they call a moment in a grand final, it sort of highlighted my father and my career together. I suppose come grand final time, it's always played at nauseam, and I'd be lying in saying that I don't enjoy it, because why wouldn't you enjoy it? You know, it's you work really hard to play rugby league and then play NRL, and Blake can attest to that, how hard it is to play week after week, and then to win a comp, it's pretty special. And then how did it change my life again? To go back to that, I don't know. It's only probably someone else can answer that from the outside looking in, as opposed to me. And I tell you what, when I go back out to Penrith, I'm always very welcomed by the fans, which is really nice.
Mate, I'm going to say it. It changed my life because I was at the game, and I was a Roosters junior, so I was going. Mm-hmm. I was there for the 3 years they went in the stretch, so I'm on the stand cheering Byrne. I'm a skinny kid like Todd Byrne. So then I realized once he got tackled, I'm like, oh, shit, I'm going to have to get a bit bigger and make those tackles. So changed my life a bit. I had to put on some weight.
Yeah. You know, I feel sorry for Skinny Byrne because actually, it was actually only last night. Actually, I never even thought this eventuated. It was only circulated. It was a five-minute interview with Skinny Byrne about how his career has been defined by – and as you know, Blake, Skinny Byrne was a really good player. He was a really good player and a tremendous guy off the field as well. And, you know, I've got to give him credit. You know, a lot of, you know, his teammates probably won't say the same thing, but, you know, he backed himself that night, and he talks about how Ricky Stewart always gave him belief in whatever decision he made, he'd always back it. And, you know, we've never spoken, Skinny and I, after that. And I just, you know, I've got to take my hat off to him because he, you know, after that he went over to the Warriors. I thought he was great over there as well. And, yeah, he's you know, it's unfortunate that two careers are remembered for two completely different things. Yeah.
We'll talk. Yeah. I'll chime in before the other guys just quickly. We talk about careers that people remember, and Benji Marshall had a moment. We all know that. And you would have played with him, Scott. I think it was 2004 because I'm a big Tigers fan, and we had a fairly solid year in 2004. We're in finals contention till pretty late. Did you feel like it was a team that was about to do something amazing? Like you had Bryce Gibbs and Heinington and Fulton and Benji and Robbie coming through. Did you feel something?
Yeah, when I arrived in the off-season of pre-season of 2004, I honestly felt as though the West Tigers had a really bad training ethic. And coming from the Panthers where we'd won the comp and we had a really great work ethic at the Panthers, I got to say, I think I went in there a little bit with a chip on my shoulder really early, after just winning the comp, and I've got to probably, well, on reflection, I probably did, and but I think I did it for a number of reasons, because really early on in the game, I recognised that they did have a really bad attitude towards a couple of disciplined areas in training, and so I think I might have rattled the cage of a few players there that had been there for a while, and I don't make any sort of excuses for that now. And but I, the reason why I went to the West Tigers, I could have gone to Souths or Manly, and I went to the West Tigers because I just wanted to be able to say that I got coached by Tim Sheens one day. You know, I just idolised him growing up as a coach and those great Canberra sides. And I'm glad I signed for 2 years, 2004, 2005. And I was made captain during that 2004 year. And Benji was in his first full year of first grade. And I remember one of our very first training sessions, we were doing a 3-on-2 drill, just a basic warm-up drill, 3 attackers, 2 defenders. And we all went through and we turned around at the other end, and Benji was up the other end by himself. He was only 18. And I said to Roy Simmons, oh, do you want two of us to go up and join him? Benji goes, no, don't worry about it. He beat the two defenders by himself in this warm-up drill. And I remember looking at Royce, and Royce just shrugged his shoulders and went, mate, he's got things I've never ever seen before. And I just knew watching him a little bit in 2003, but then watching him at training and the things that he did, like he practiced those flick passes all the time. And Blake, you've been there. The amount of work he puts into his basic skills is quite amazing. And then Robbie was still coming through the grade, but you heard about this kid that was coming through. Liam Fulton was there, Chris Hynington, Bryce Gibbs, Johnny Scandalis was a tremendous player. And then, yeah, Buckets O'Neill. But then they'd also signed Brett Hodgson, Scottie Prince, Toddy Payton, and Pat Richards, and Shane Elford. And Shane Elford was an amazing defensive centre. And so they bought some players that had come from clubs that had tasted a little bit of success. You know, the Roosters with Toddy, and then Parramatta were really good through that period with Hodgson and also Paddy Richards, and Scottie Prince was a really good young up-and-coming halfback. So you could feel something emerging, and we had to win one of the last three games to make the finals. And we got beaten in all those three games. And so we finished 9th, and, you know, like the Tigers always do. But, missed out in the finals. But, yeah, I could feel something really building. And early on in the 2005 year, I remember talking to Timmy Sheens on the phone one day, and I said, after about 4 or 5 rounds, I just said, the style that these young guys are playing, I think you'll win it this year. And at that time he goes, oh, mate, I think we're a couple of years away yet, but at least we're on the same path, the right path. But, but having a coach like him, having a coach like Timmy Sheens, you're always going to taste some sort of success.
Your team in 03, do you see a lot of this Panthers side sort of similar? Like, I mean, you've got the half who's sort of like Gower, then you've got sort of the 5'8", Luai, Preston Campbell, you've got the agile back rowers, the young wingers like Rooney and Lewis. Do you see a lot of similarities?
You know, it's an interesting thing you say there, Blake. I was doing an interview yesterday with Peter Bedell, one of the chief league writers over here in Australia, and he's doing a story on Sunday, I think. Grand Final Day, about the similarities in the biomechanics of each of the players, and you've hit the nail on the head. Every team's got to have a lunatic to win a comp, and this team's got James Fisher-Harris, who I've got no doubt's a serial killer at night time, and then you've got Appy Corrissau, a really crafty hooker who picks his times, and we had Luke Prittis, who I still think today is one of the greatest individual performances I've ever seen in a Grand Final. Then you've got Viliami Kikau and Tony Pulitua. You've got the halfback, like you said, who can tackle like a back rower, has a really good kicking game, is as tough as a $2 steak. And then you've got Jerome Luai with Preston Campbell. You've got Paul Momorowski is a bit of an unsung hero like Paul Fatawira. You've got Luke Lewis, who would have 25 hit-ups a game when he's playing on the wing as a 19-year-old in our premiership winning side, and you've got Brian Tighe, who has 25 hit-ups a game as well. And So yeah, there's a heap of similarities, and you've got a father and son coach and player. There's so many parallels. And I said this last year as well. So many parallels between both the sides. It's quite frightening, actually. And we played this. We were a good defensive side, but we weren't a great defensive side. We had the mentality: if you're going to score 20, we'll score 40, and if you want to score 30, we'll still score 40. We used to frighten a lot of sides, and they knew that we were coming for them. I remember we were playing the Broncos in the qualifying final, first versus eighth. We were first, they were eighth. And I get on really well with Benny Eichen, and I was running down for a kick chase, and he was sort of running back. And they were leading, I think it was 14-4 or 16-4 in the qualifying final. And I said, "How are you going, Ikey?" He goes, "I can just feel you guys coming. I know you guys are coming." And we ended up beating them convincingly. I think it was like 28-16 or something, 26-16 in that qualifying final. And so I scared a lot of teams. And this Penrith team's exactly the same. They'll defend you like they did against Melbourne. But if they get in the right frame of mind, they'll just put 30 on you in a heartbeat.
Who was your lunatic?
Martin Lane.
Oh, that was your lunatic, yeah. Okay. Silly question.
You know, I still recall it. You know, there's little things in games that a lot of people don't see, but I remember he got knocked out twice cold in that grand final. Adrian Morley hit him once, Jason Kalis and hit him again, and Luke Ricketson hit him off a kickoff. He was knocked out cold. Trainers had to pick him up and push him back into the line. He was spitting all over himself. His eyes were closed. And you still talk to him today. He can't remember the game. He's got to watch it on DVD. But I remember there was a run. We were leading 12-6. I think it was like 68th minute, I think it might have been. And I thought all the water out of the well had gone. I thought we'd dried up. I thought we'd done everything we could to beat this Roosters side. And even though we were winning 12-6, I still thought, I don't know how much longer we can hold on against this great Roosters side. And all of a sudden, he ran onto this ball, and Ricketson and Fitzgibbon and all of them come running out of the line to try and finish him off for the third time. And they just all ricocheted off him, and he kept running for about another 10 or 12 metres. And yeah. I was like, you know what, it's just our night. No one's going to beat us tonight. And it's sort of that run to me just went, we've got to go to another gear now, because this guy's been knocked out twice and he's still leading the way.
In 03, you fellas had the week off. Now, we've been talking on the show about having a week off. Penrith haven't had one. And there was talk about last week they're going to run out of gas. They just kept turning up. When you get to a GF, I wasn't lucky enough to ever get to one. You were. Do you just always find something? There's just something always there. It's the gas tank's always full.
Depends how you play the week out. As you know, before you play big games, you can play the game out around in your head so many times that you just become mentally fatigued. And you play the game in your head before, you run out in the field, and the first 5 minutes you feel like your legs feel like lead. Yeah. The best part for us, we had the week off, which I think we needed. We had a lot of play. We had Craig Gow played with a cracked sternum for about 12 weeks. He took needles into every game. And we had Girdler had a bad sternum injury as well. Lang had a bad ankle. So we needed that week off, and so we loved it. Penrith haven't had the week off this time, but I think this Penrith team, you've got to keep them engaged. You've got to keep them in games. And I think playing every week has really battle-hardened them. Everyone was expecting for them to run out of gas, but you become really battle-hardened and fight through the elements when you do it the way that Penrith have done it. That's why I think they go into this game and they deservedly need to go in as favourites, because they're battle-hardened and ready to go. Now, there is an argument that they played their grand final last week. When we played the Roosters in 03, they beat the Bulldogs the week before, and many thought that they'd played the Bulldogs their grand final the week before and they'd run out of gas leading into us. So that's going to be an argument for Penrith. You know, did they play their grand final last week, beating one of the greatest teams we've ever seen in the modern era? So only time will tell in the first 20 minutes whether that's the case, but I loved having the weekend off. I was 31. I had some niggling injuries. I just – having that week off and sitting back and watch the other teams just bash each other, that was just heaven for me. But then I remember speaking to Luke Rooney and Luke Lewis and Joel Clinton, all these 19, 20-year-olds, and they didn't know what to do with themselves. They had the weekend off and they're just trying to find something to do. So we had to try and keep them engaged in the game as opposed to going to their mates and getting on the drink or going and eating a heap of crap food. So we had to try and keep them engaged that weekend and not let them just run off with the fairies.
So you mentioned, we're getting into like the preview of the game. You mentioned one of the great coaches in Sheensy, now possibly the greatest in his last game in charge of South. What's the Bennett factor like? What does this mean in your mind for South Sydney's chances?
Yeah, he's the greatest coach we'll ever see. I think the only one's ever going to come close to him is, you know, obviously Gibson, which a lot of us didn't see, and Craig Bellamy with the effect that he's had on players. But it's amazing, Wayne Bennett, the success that he has, but he doesn't think he has to change his philosophy. Now, a lot of coaches change their philosophy. They overcomplicate things. His game plan is so simplistic, it's quite frightening that he's had so much success. I remember in Origin, and he was the coach, I was rooming with Petro Sivanasiva, and day three, I was sitting on the end of the bed of a 10-day Origin camp, and I said, his nickname's Buller, Petro. And I said, hey, Buller, when are we going to start breaking down New South Wales and looking at game plans? And Petro said, no, there's no game plan. I said, what? He says, no game plan. He said, just don't miss tackles, be really aggressive, have a lot of energy, be there for your mate, and give the ball to Lockie when he wants it. And so I talked to the South players, and I do a lot of work on SEN with Gary Belcher, who won comps and won Origins with Wayne. And he said it's amazing how the game plan is all built around just high levels of energy and be there for your mate and just be really disciplined. So it'll be no different this week. I suppose a window into the soul of Wayne's coaching was last week when, for more reports, I was told from good authority that when Melbourne played Manly, Bellamy and his coaches did so much research on Tommy Trbojevic and the best way to try and shut him down, they did. When Wayne Bennett was asked, how do you shut down Tom Trbojevic? He says, when he's got the ball in his hands, you just got to tackle him. And that's his focus. So what he does, the closer he gets to a grand final, the closer he gets to a big game, he simplifies it even more and he'll halve that. And then when he feels as though that things are getting a little bit out of hand, he'll go and pick a fight with someone in the media, or he'll pick something, or, you know, they've fired a shot over the bow already. They've said Panthers head trainer Hayden Knowles spends too much time on the field. So that takes the focus away from playing group and puts it on somewhere else. He's just the master of it. He's a master of manipulation.
The best.
It's interesting you say, Scotty, about, you know, the high energy being there for your mates. I think we saw that with Cody Walker last week. In particular, his two tries, and the second one, he was dead. He was gone 20 metres behind the play, the ball on his back, and he gets up out of nowhere and scores this try. Yeah, it's remarkable to see and hear that game plan sort of stood the test of time.
He just says to his players, if you go down, you got to come off. So if you're on the ground and you can get yourself off the ground, I need you up straight away. I need you in the line. I need you being there for your mate. It's all about being there for your mate. He lost the grand final in 1984. He coached South Magpies in 84, and they played Wynnum. And Wynnum Manly had, you know, Colin Scott, State of Origin fullback, Wally Lewis, Gene Miles, Greg Dowling, all these, you know, the French brothers, Gary Coyne. This half the Queensland side played for this one club team. And they absolutely flogged South Magpies in the grand final of 84. Fast forward 12 months, they play them again. They beat them 10-8, I think, in the grand final, South Magpies. And Wayne Bennett says it was the making of him as a coach that off-season. Going 84 into 85, that was the making of him as a coach. From that day on, he's never changed his philosophies.
Wow. You earlier you mentioned Luke Prittis, who had a monster of a game in the grand final and was rightly named the Clive Churchill medal winner. We're going to have a look at that a wee bit later, but if you look at this grand final, where do you think the most likely Clive Churchill medal winner comes from?
If South Sydney win, I think it's Damien Cook, because I think if South Sydney to win the game, they've got to they've got to beat this very young, quick, agile Penrith Panthers side. Their forward pack's so young, and so they're just, you know, they recover quickly because they're so young. So if they're going to win, they've got to win the battle in the forwards. Like, they've got to stop James Fisher-Harris and Moses Leota and Kikau and Isaiah Yeo and co, Liam Martin. And if they do that, I think Damon Cook has an absolute field day. And if Penrith win, I think Jerome Luai is the one that opens the game up and is the difference. Penrith have learned how to win without Nathan now. When he had those weeks off with his shoulder injury, I think they relied on Nathan too much. I think they learnt how to not to rely on him now. And yes, the Appy Coruscant was really good last week. Jerome was really good last week. Isaiah is good every week. So, you know, I think Jerome Luai wins the game if Penrith win, because I think it'll be an open game. And if South win, I think Damien Cook.
Very nice.
Can I say about the Luke Prittis? I mean, I also feel sorry for Luke Prittis from that grand final, because, you know, when we talk about the grand final, I'm glad you brought him up. You know, everyone talks about my moment, and I think it's not fair on Luke Prittis, who, you know, a lot of the limelight gets taken off him, because, like I said, I thought it was one of the greatest individual performances I've ever seen. And just to give you some context, he won a comp in 2000 with the Broncos, came to the Penrith Panthers, and we'd come off a wooden spoon and second or third last in 2002. And he came to the club, and from a training point of view, he got under the skin of a lot of players, because he just expected better from some players. And you're leading into that grand final. Him and John Lang used to always be at loggerheads because they're two ex-hookers. And but leading into that final series, he punctured his lung and missed the Broncos game. We played the Warriors 2 weeks later, and he played and scored a really important try, but still only had 70% oxygen capacity in his lungs. And when he played the grand final the final week, he trained one session and came down with bronchitis because of the punctured lung and the lack of oxygen he could get to his lungs. He then got bronchitis and bordered on pneumonia by Thursday, and then came out and played on Sunday and scored one try and set up two. Like, just amazing, unbelievable.
Brilliant game. It was an awesome game. I think it was $21 to win Clive Churchill that day. It was one of the great performances.
I guess looking at the grand final tomorrow, we've got the Wayne Bennett factor. We've got the young Penrith guns factor. So if you're going to put your money on the table, which way are you heading, Scott?
Well, I win either way, because my favourite team, South Sydney, win, and the team I love also, Penrith, win. And I also get disappointed either way as well. But I think Penrith win 28-16. I think Jerome Luai is the Clive Churchill medal winner. Yeah, I just think defensively, I mean, South have been the best defensive side after the Origin period. We've seen the statistics. But I just think you need to get it all right for 3 weeks in the finals period. And I think South, even though they lost that first week, could have won it 16-10. Then they conceded 8 points against 6 points against Parramatta, and then conceded 6 points against the Melbourne Storm. Yeah, I think they're going in, and I'm saying that now at the moment, with all the players that have been named. Now, there's a big chance Dylan Edwards won't play. Now, he doesn't appear in a lot of the highlights, the try-scoring highlights, but what I do know is that he adds balance to the side. They're a different side when he's not there. So if he plays, I think Penrith win. If he doesn't play, I think South win.
Wow.
If he doesn't play, does Crichton go to fullback and they bring in either Staines or Naden?
Yeah,
or?
I think they'll put Naden on the wing and Crichton to fullback.
And that happened week one, didn't it?
It did. Was there? Yeah, it did. Against
South? Yeah.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Mm.
Oh,
do you think, you know, we talked, Blake brought up before, we talked about how we all thought that the Penrith boys were gassed after that effort against the Eels defensively. You know, we talked about they're young, they bounce back, all that. But what does 2 weeks like that that defensive effort for 2 weeks straight due to the body?
Yeah, it's a good question. I mean, and Blake, you can attest to this as well. The modern game is not about how much work you do on the field. It's how you rehab now. It's all about rehab. It's, they very rarely spend much time on the footy field these days. It's all, you know, stretching bands and physios and massages, and then they'll stretch again. And so, and because they're a young group, they'll recover straight away. I remember Luke Lewis, who was just a freak at training, like just a freak of nature, what he used to do. But I remember we played this game once. He would have been 20 at the stage, yeah. I remember we played the Bulldogs and it was such a bruising affair. It was like 28-26. We beat them on a Sunday afternoon at Penrith Stadium. And it was a really, really torrid affair. And I remember driving the next morning to go to rehab at the local Penrith pool. And Luke Lewis was running to the rehab. And I stopped. I said, "Do you want to lift?" He goes, "No, no." Now he lives seven kilometers away from the pool. And I said, "What are you doing?" He goes, "Oh, I just want to do a little bit extra work." I said, "Either you didn't do enough yesterday or you're just mad." So these young players, they just recover. They recover quicker. And as Blake was saying, you're leading into a grand final. You find this extra burst of energy. You just, it's like a shot of adrenaline.
I guess
that sort of put him in good stead, Luke Lewis, because he slowly started moving inwards along the back line into the forward pack, but he was around to win another grand final, the Sharks' first ever grand final. So I guess it's a lesson for younger players. You put the effort in and you'll get as much out as you put in, sort of thing. And because he was so, as you say, put in that extra work, he was able to prolong his career and play at a high level and win another grand final. Can you, I guess we've got a lot of punters here who are really interested in how the Warriors go. And I know you mentioned when you moved and you moved from a club that has good structure and you move to another club and they're not as structured. I think Blake will probably, I think I saw Blake leaning on the fence at Mount Smart with a pie and a can of Coke at some trainings. So if you went to the Warriors, how would you go about changing the culture there, I guess, or the structures that they have?
I think they're on the right path, the Warriors. I'm a big fan of Cameron George, their CEO. Nathan Brown, from all reports, from players I've spoken to, from all reports, he's a very good coach and he's a real player-invested coach. He likes being close to his players. There's been a lot of trials and tribulations on how the Warriors play their best footy. Getting them fitter and being able to play for long periods of time. I remember playing against the Warriors and it was always the mindset, just getting into an arm wrestle with them, by 60 minutes, they'll fold. And a lot of the times at Penrith, we had a really good success against the Warriors with that mindset. And I think, yeah, there's this also this mindset that let them play like the Harlem Globetrotters. Just let them offload at will and that's when they play their best footy. Or let them play really high disciplined, high percentages, high completion rates. And I think sometimes some of the Warriors play, especially the New Zealand-based Polynesian boys, I think they sometimes get bored with the game when they've got to play that way. I don't know. I may be wrong. This is an outsider looking in, and Blake might be able to comment on this further. But I think the mapping of success for the Warriors is that they've got to have in a perfect world, it would have been great for the Warriors to have Adam Reynolds. He's a really good structured halfback that you can have all these enigmatic players around him that are really unpredictable, but you just got that one guy that says, "Hey, guys, we're at the 34th minute mark. We're leading by 8 into halftime. We're just going to batten down the hatches, and this is what we're going to do, okay, and just keep everyone on course." I think it's only one player the Warriors need. I don't think they need three or four players. I think they're on the right path. They just need one player. At the end of 2022, there's a lot of players coming off contract, and I expect the Warriors to be really active in the market.
Beautiful.
I'm excited.
Well, what do you like? I mean,
I look at the things like you said before about Luke Prittis or even you going to the Tigers. You look at the Warriors when James Maloney came. Now, he came from a Storm system, you know? So he's been around winners. He's been around that culture. So he's brought that in, and he would have, you know, he's a larrikin and things, but he knows how to train right and get ready. I just think they need to buy a player from a winning culture, such as yourself going to the Tigers or a Luke Prittis going to Penrith. And it is only that one player, like you said, who I think can change everything there. They got all the pieces. It's just that one person, I think.
Yeah, like I look at Mitchell Pearce. I know he's under contract next year, but if you were able to get Mitchell for 2 years to go to the Warriors, and he's that player that just says, hey, guys, we're just going to train that hard and this is the way we're going to play our footy, and the coach and player have a really good relationship. You know, you might pay him overs, but what happens in the years after he leaves is he leaves this really good blueprint into winning rugby league games. And he's a winner, Mitchell. I know his origin career says he's not, but he's won a comp, and he's always been a frontline halfback player at regular season level. And yeah, that's the sort of player I think the Warriors need. They just need that real process driven half that's willing just to steer the side around.
Anything else, Fisky? Anything not to do with the Tigers?
Oh, well, there goes 25 questions. So, no. No, I think I really appreciate
it. Something, Fisky. I'll tell you something that a lot of people don't know. During that 2004 year when Scottie Prince had come down from the Broncos, halfway through the year, he wasn't playing great rugby league. And he was really homesick. He lived out in Penrith where I did, and we used to travel in all the time. He was really homesick. Tim Sheens called him in before June 30, and I was there as part of the meeting because he knew that we got on really well together and we travelled together and we spoke a lot. And he actually was going to release him before June 30, and he even said to him, if you want to go home, I'll release you now.
Wow.
So sliding door moment where Princey said, no, nah, you know what, no, I just need to toughen up. I need to knuckle down. I need to focus on being the player that you signed me for. Goes on, Clive Churchill medal winner and a premiership winning captain.
Yeah, what a year. What a year. Wow. Can we just do a podcast on the 2005 Grand Final next week? Give me something.
We'd never get out of the studio, fair dinkum.
Yeah.
No, that's awesome insight, Scott. Like, mate, can't wait for Sunday. And like you say, you're a winner either way, Penrith or South.
Yeah, and a loser.
And you did mention earlier as well that they play you the tackle ad nauseum. I think they could play it every day of the year and it wouldn't be enough. That was a huge, huge moment. I know just one small sporting moment, but I think it was a huge moment in the game. And it's a moment that I don't forget.
It's Reece West's fault because he's the one. My nickname was Scooter. And I remember when I was chasing Toddy, and there was a moment, there's a split moment when Toddy and I caught eyes. We actually caught eyes at one stage, and he was deciding what he was going to do. But I remember you can't hear the crowd and I don't know about you, Blake, you can never hear big crowds for some reason. You can hear the player next to you, you can hear the other side, but you can't hear the crowd, and it was totally silent. But all I could hear was Reece Wesher saying to me, Scooter, I got you inside. Scooter, I got you inside. So I thought, if I just keep chasing, he steps inside, Reece West has got him. So I just kept chasing, and anyway, the way it ended up, I remember leaning back and just looking back at the field. Reece West was dead set 30 metres away, nowhere near him. So he bluffed me.
It was one of the great rugby league moments. I think the second greatest was Benji's flick pass against Parramatta about 2010 where Blake scored, but they delete the bit where Blake puts the ball down.
They do delete that, mate. That's I go to show the kids every day, and every day, every hour, I should say, and it's not there. So,
can I give a shout out for the third greatest moment? It was probably Skinny Burns' redemption. I think maybe the next year for the Warriors when he made a 100-meter breakaway try against the Bunnies to win the game, but he was running on a treadmill, caught by everyone.
Yeah.
Oh, brilliant. Well, Scott, thanks so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. We'd love to have you back again sometime next season. You've given us some great insights, and we can maybe touch on your time at the Gold Coast Seagulls and a few of the other teams that you knocked around with as well. So
there's plenty to talk about with the Gold Coast and the South Queensland Crushers. I remember when we got the Gold Coast Chargers, Shooters Nightclub was our major sponsor. And 1997, we had a really good year. We made the finals, first time Gold Coast had ever made the finals, and we beat Illawarra in week one and went through and played the Roosters week two. But every time a team come and played us, and usually on a Saturday night, they'd get off the plane at Coolangatta, and the Shooters showgirls would be there with free drink cards. So before we even played them, we just had them on toast straight away.
Yeah. Awesome. Oh, there's just a little snippet of what you can expect next time, punters, when we talk to Scott Sattler, rugby league legend in our parts, fair dinkum. Thanks so much, Scott. We really appreciate your time today. Good luck with the call on Sunday night, and all the best. And we will get you back sometime next season.
And to all my in-laws at Oamaru, Timaru, Queenstown, Christchurch, and Nelson, g'day.
Oh, beautiful.
Thanks, Nelson.
Awesome. Thanks,
see you
guys.
Cheers, mate.
That was
awesome.
Who was that?
When he was talking about like Marley Lang getting knocked out twice and bouncing back, it just reminded me of Paul Moati Saturday night at El Horno. You think he's gone, and then you see him back at the bar and the dance floor. That's the kind of leader Paul is.
The state of origin sweepstake party we had. Where Paul went down, succumbed to a calf injury, and it was back.
Calf, mate. I'm 100% again, though. Don't worry about that. Heading into summer. Right, where do we go from? That was just sensational. It was brilliant to have Scott Sattler on, and the stories that he had. Of course, he's rugby league through and through, with his dad, of course, being a big premiership winner with the Bunnies. I think they won almost in a row in the late 60s, early 70s.
Yeah, we didn't talk about a lot because we didn't have a lot of time with Scott, and there was so much that he achieved. But his dad, make no mistake, he's rugby league royalty at South Sydney Rabbitohs. He's in the pantheon of South Sydney greats, and there's a few. So, yeah, we probably could have a podcast just talking about Johnny Sattler because he was a brilliant player in his own right.
Right, we'll move back to the now. And I guess before we get to the real rugby league, we probably have to talk about a few. Rugby league is a sport that just keeps giving and giving, whether on or off the field. And the past week, we've seen Reece Walsh argue with the police, probably not at the best of times. But the way the club and himself have handled it, I guess you could give them a pass for that. Not a pass on what he actually had on him, but the fact that they stepped up, said, yeah, did wrong, and these are the steps we're taking to correct it. Blake, you?
Yeah, I sort of see both sides of it. I mean, I'm happy the Warriors – not happy, I mean, yes, the Warriors did good in front-footing it and putting Reece Walsh out there, but then I see the other side – he's a 19-year-old kid who has to tell a couple of countries, go around the world, that he's done this, when most 19-year-olds who would have, there's probably about 30 on at that scene that probably got done the same, and they would have had to go on home and maybe told their parents or maybe not. So, I mean, it's big from Reece as a kid to come out and put a statement forward and admit that on national TV. I just hope it does him more good than harm. Yeah,
first kid gets on your 19.
I think taking the illicit substance talk out of it, I think you got to smarten up if you want to. We talked about Luke Lewis and professional footballers achieving. Well, yeah, there's a society issue that he's fallen into a trap. But if you want to be the best, and I'm talking, he's got the ability. Okay. Maybe slip up here and there, but if he wants to achieve the top level rugby league for 10 plus years, you just got to get that out of your game. You just got to be smarter than that. And great players like Brad Fittler and that, yeah, they slipped up when they were kids, but they towards the end of the end of their career, there was no time for that. It was top of their game, setting good examples to their teammates, but just playing at the top of your game. And hopefully he learns from this because, yeah, it's a learning experience. So, yeah, I think the Warriors will see the upside of it next year. He'll smarten up a bit and just focus on working on himself. And, yeah, it's no big deal in the scheme of things, but hopefully you get a learning lesson out of it.
Carl, that you being a huge Warriors fan, this hits right in the heart of your well-being, actually. You okay with how the situation's been handled since his indiscretion?
Yeah, it's a tough one. We talk about it every week. We have talked about it every week. Something's going to happen next week, and we're going to be talking about that. The front-footed it. He's done wrong. He said he's done wrong. Move on. Don't, like I said, don't, let's not talk about it any longer and drag this kid down. Let's just move on.
You know that what will happen because he's 19, say plays for 11 years, those one-liners are going to come out, those memes and things like that, that he's just going to have to deal with. But that's all part of it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, there are a few other players who are in sort of on the wrong end of a camera. Some of the Storm players who seem to be enjoying the night. I think pre-Dally M's. Melbourne Storm have taken a different sort of way of handling the situation. Fiske, you okay with how that one has unfolded?
Yeah, I think it's a little bit different. Police weren't involved. There's nothing been proven. It's not a good look, but I think they're just waiting to see how it plays out. I think it's a bit crook. Forgetting what actually happened, I think it's a bit crook that you can't trust your mates to not share a video like that, regardless of what happened, and we don't know what happened. So I think people sharing that in social media and then people like us talking about it, it's kind of uncalled for. Like, it should just be kept behind closed doors. Blokes after a long season, not condoning anything, but nothing should come out unless we know exactly what happened. And, yeah, I just reckon it's crook. Whoever took that video it's a grubby act.
Blake, surely the video taker isn't a mate anymore.
Oh, and the worst thing is if he's gone and I don't know, he would have shared it or he would have asked for money for it. I'm not sure how it got out. But those boys in the room would have known who had taken the video. You know, probably for those two, they're going to be all right just because they're the players that they are. I mean, this is a stain on them, yeah. But like Fiske said, there's no proof that anything. I mean, everyone knows what was happening. But it just brings the game into disrepute. I think it is. That's why they get the fine and the match ban. But Chris Lewis was there as well, so I don't know how that's going to play out for him. Plays okay. He's a first grader, but he's not like the other two. So whether they would have to treat him the same, you'd think, or would they treat him differently and let him go?
I hope. I actually don't mind the two strikes policy. This is where it actually has a bit of an advantage. I think everyone, a bit of a slip up. None of them are kind of promoting it or doesn't look like a regular issue. It's sort of end of the season. If they do it again, it's a different conversation. Okay. So I think rugby league is one of the great forgiving sports and I'm cut from a similar cloth. Everyone can have a shocker. It's about how they respond. And I think someone like a Cheese or a Munster, and Munster had a shocker last week. So he now has to make sure that how he starts 2022 it's really important for him. He's got to pull his head in.
Yeah, I think rugby league, they certainly get a lot of opportunities to be forgiving. So, Carl, these guys move on. What do we do?
Yeah, same deal. It's like Fiske said, the more we talk about it, the worse we make it. Let's just move on. I do not condone what they were doing, but I also don't care enough to keep talking about it.
Let's talk Dally M's then.
Lovely.
Dally M's part two.
Talking about not caring enough, Dally M's, throw that in the mix. Oh, it's off a cliff this year.
how wrong were we? Where's the NRL gone? Olam, centre, in the team of the year.
I know.
He wasn't in the top three, a couple of weeks ago.
The top five.
Oh, my goodness.
I just think the transparency around how they calculate all that, and look, it was always probably going to be a bit of a fizz. Everyone knew that Tommy T was going to win and deserved it. So let's give him credit. It was an amazing season. So just the way it played out and the voting and the fact you can't bet on it, that's a big one for me. once you take that off the table, I'm not really watching.
Yeah. Yeah, I just had a problem. I didn't watch it or see any of it. The next day I seen the team list, team of the year, and I just had two people that I don't think... I mean, Burton had a great year, but I think Joey Manu still proved he's the best centre in the game and probably should have been the other centre with Olam. And Viliami Kikau plays 50, 60 minutes a game and hasn't had his best year this year, even though Penrith are winning. I mean... I know Fifita didn't have a good year, but he started the year was enormous. I mean, you've got Angus Crichton, who played Origin, who was enormous. I mean, there's a list of back rows who I thought were ahead of him, but they'd be my only two beefs out of that team. I think the rest of
even the rookie Carl. Like forgetting what happened in the Gold Coast, I think Reece Walsh was easily the best player of the year in terms of rookies. I thought Sam for the Roosters, he kind of went missing after about round 13, 14.
They said that Walsh was ineligible because he got banned twice. Why not?
Oh, is that what it was?
Why even put him in the conversation?
If he was never going to get it.
Yeah, that again, dumb move on.
Papali'i deserves.
Oh, easy.
Yeah.
And he's become almost twice the player he was at the Warriors. Is that... through a change of atmosphere, a change of culture at Parramatta? But Blake, can you sort of help us out?
He's always been a big, powerful kid. You know, I think the home life back here sort of gets a lot of kids. You know, they're comfortable. He's gone over there sort of on a one-year deal, I think it was. It might have been. It wasn't much more if it was. You know, had to fight for his spot when he went over. I spoke to him the start of the year, and he had to fight for his spot. And then he just proved from round one. I can't remember him having a bad game, to be honest. Even when the Eels lost, he was huge. Yeah, so I think it is that a different, a change of scenery, a different vibe, different coach. I think that's what really brought the best out of him.
A little bit of playing for his supper.
Yeah, I think some players thrive when they're the go-to man, whereas he can lean on Paulo, Regan Campbell-Gillard, Nathan Brown. Like, he might thrive in within a huge and talented pack, and he just wants to keep up with them. And probably never had that luxury in the Warriors.
Should we have a look back at the preliminary finals now? The Bunnies were – the game was over after about 20-odd minutes. They were totally dominant. The Seagulls really didn't have much to offer at all. Carl, can you look at that and take any positives out for the Seagulls?
Not really. To be honest, all my notes here are chirping up how good the Bunnies were. Taff, I thought he was great at fullback. His game awareness and his passing, those two tries that Johnson scored off his passes were incredible. I mentioned Cody Walker earlier. I think his effort plays were huge. And, you know, we even got to see a bit of Benji magic with that try assist to Campbell Graham too. 22-0 halftime. You can't come back from that. That's good game.
Fisky, the game went according to plan by Bennett, but is that how you saw it as well?
Yeah, Carl's right. Like, they were never really in it. South looked good, but it was one of those ones. Like, a few things went against Manly, just as a few things went for South in the first 20 minutes, a couple of tries disallowed, and every time Manly looked like they're going to come into it, there's a little bit of bad luck. So I still think they're off the pace and the better team won. But if you knew before kickoff that Reynolds wasn't going to kick for goal nor be involved in general play kicking, because Cody Walker's a lot less effective, you kind of would have started to worry. So, but as it was, South got the perfect start, good enough to just keep pushing away. Yeah, they never really got out of second gear. They had the game in control. It was actually a nice soft win leading into a GF. They've had their tough wins. They probably needed a little let up. So, yeah, they'll be fresh as a daisy. Reynolds probably better for the run. And, yeah, Bennett very confident, very confident.
Blake Manly were a little unlucky early on. They had, I think, Garrett crossed, and then that try was called back for a penalty or an indiscretion further back. Tommy T fumbled the ball over the line. The scoreline could have been a wee bit closer at halftime if those things had gone the Seagulls' way. But could you have seen the Seagulls getting over the top in the end of a Bunny side that just seemed relentless?
Look, I've got to give it to you. We spoke last week. I thought it'd be a close game. I mean, maybe, you know, the Bunnies' edge defence was a bit suspect, which is worrying going into a grand final. To, you know, how often does Tommy Turbo get stopped once he's over the line? So a bit did go their way, but I still think, like we said, they were the better team. I think they limited what Turbo did. And I think, yeah, Cameron Murray is, for me, he's huge. And he's a big factor this weekend. I just think with him in that side, their middle, their pack, they're not the biggest names. They're still young players as well on the edge, but he just brings them just that professionalism, just that X factor for me. He's just rock solid, and I thought he was a huge difference in that game.
I know the conditions were totally different Friday night to Saturday, but the Rabbitohs, and this goes on Scott's point about energy in defence and how Bennett wants them playing, and they've got better every week. Their speed off the line was phenomenal. Yeah. So Murray led that. Joy Arrow's playing his best footy. By a mile. Burgess off the bench is just unstoppable at the moment. He's kind of channeling George from 2014. And, they're just that pace they've got now, like in defence and in attack. So Murray's footwork laid at the line and just the speed. I thought the Saturday game was a slugathon, but even from the word go, it just seemed a lot slower. It was a strange game Saturday.
Shall we have a little talk about that game then? The Storm, who were quite warm favourites, getting undone by the Panthers. The Panthers defensively were huge. They're a number. We were just talking to Scott Sattler, of course, and because of the tackle, there are a number of try-saving tackles in that game from both sides. But Penrith did enough to win in the end. Could you see? I watched and I was never quite comfortable with the slender lead that the Panthers had. But in the end, it was enough. Fiske, you're happy enough with the display there?
Oh, like Penrith, credit to them. Like they did what they had to do. And I wouldn't be raving about their attack. Like they scored in the third or fourth minute of both halves and that was really it. Melbourne were atrocious. They dropped the ball. Every time they built pressure, they'd let it off. And then when they got a bit of ball towards the end of each half, they had just no energy. I can't explain it. They were void of ideas and they weren't building towards anything. It was a real shotgun attacking performance. I thought Nelson Asofa Solomona was one out towards the end. He was trying to create some spark and there was no one going with him. Maybe Grant didn't have the miles in his legs. Because he was forced to play long minutes. I was expecting him to push up. Pat wasn't pushing up through the middle. They didn't get Hines on soon enough for mine. I'll give Jerome Hughes a wrap. I thought he was almost the best player on the field as well. But outside of him, outside of those two I mentioned, there was just no one for the Storm. I was super disappointed, because I don't think Penrith were unstoppable, and you know they forced Melbourne to these errors. Melbourne forced it on themselves. It was pitiful.
Do you think the balance of the Storm team was upset so much by the loss of Brandon Smith and then Christian Welsh that
I reckon before they went off, and I know Welsh went off early, but I think even before Brandon went off, they weren't with it from almost the first 5 minutes. They just weren't themselves. They were second guessing themselves in attack a lot, and it was just like I say, the pace was really slow. So I look, Brandon, you'd love him there, and they might have won if he stayed on, but they just seemed off.
Yeah, mate, they were dropping, like the balls they were dropping were on the edge and things like that. They had nothing to do with, I think, Christian Welch and Brandon Smith. I know you get an extra punch with them there, but I think the forwards that for Melbourne that actually had to play big minutes, like Tui had a huge game, you know, but playing big minutes, I think 50, 60 minutes. Jesse, and you already mentioned Nelson. I mean, they did their job in the middle. I just think the edges let them down a bit with those drop balls. Jerome Hughes was trying his hardest. Munster, you said, had a very bad game. 16 errors and I'm guessing maybe 10 or more unforced. I mean, yeah, you can't win. And like you said, Penrith, they're a good defensive side. I thought it was there to be won. And I thought once Melbourne had scored, I mean, I thought, oh, geez, here they come. But, you know, I hope at least one punter out there followed my gut from last week. I did have that feeling in my gut. I said someone follow it because I certainly didn't. I backed the Storm. So I hope someone got up and backed it.
Carl, just too many mistakes from the Storm.
Yeah, it was. It was disappointing. They looked slow in attack, like Fisky said, second guessing themselves. It just looked weird and off. But having said that, that game I could not take my eyes off. It was as terrible as Melbourne were. The game itself, I thought, was incredible. The first half was maybe the best first half I've seen in 10 years of rugby league. And then the second half was just as good. The All Blacks got put on record and we turned that on later. That's where I was at Saturday. Very disappointed I didn't get my my grand final South yes. into Melbourne bet up either. Very disappointed.
Penrith have just quickly, it was a great game and taken nothing away. I just hope that the grand final's not talked about like it has been this week with the Penrith game about the refereeing situation. I know Cleary's sort of got the rub of the green since his last first Bennett. There was a couple of questionable calls in the Para game and a couple of calls again on the weekend with Jerome Hughes' head highs and things like that. So I just hope we're not talking about it next week.
I'm sure we won't be. we never do. I guess before we get on to our bits, Fisky, did you want to have a little chat about the Super League?
Oh, yeah. Look, it's probably a good time because we're getting to this is, you know, the last game in the NRL, but it's also heating up in the UK. And Blake and I liked Leeds last week, so it's heating right up there. And I think it's worth calling out. Catalan Dragons were top of the table, and they're hosting Hull KR on Thursday night, and it's sold out in Perpignan. James Maloney's last home game. He's going to stay in France and play lower leagues for Lezignan or something, one of the teams there. So he's loving it there. There's talk Catalan will pick up Mitchell Pearce next year. I think it's going to be a brilliant game. So everyone get up early on Friday morning. Catalan Dragons, I think, absolute specials at the minus against Hull KR. It's come through a real tough game. I think they'll win 20+. And the winner of that goes to Old Trafford to probably meet St Helens. But Leeds have lifted, and I think their clash with Saints will be really good. So, yeah, I know we've got the footy on Sunday, but there's two really good games on Friday morning and Saturday morning, New Zealand time.
You thinking along the same lines in regards to the Super League, Blake?
Yeah, mate. Catalans have been the best all year. Hull KR, that's massive. I know they got Brad Takarangi, Sean Kenny-Dowles over there, and old warrior Albert Vetti, who had a year with the Storms over there. Mate, that's huge because they were last year. So for them to even beat the other Hull FC team in the rankings and now win that first game, it'll be big. But like Fisky said, I think Hadlands and St. Helens meet in the final.
There we go. A nice little start to a rugby league multi. Cal? You're a big fan of the Super League?
Oh, I've got nothing on the Super League, to be honest, Paul.
Yeah, good as gold. Fisky, you also wanted to have a little chat about some guy who's played a few games of rugby league, 300 odd, and I don't know, this could be his last game, maybe not.
Maybe, maybe not, and that's the beauty of Benji. He loves the theatre. He loves the spotlight. Blake knows him super well. Scotty knows him pretty well. And it's not till you hear stories about the 2003 Grand Final, you know, where Scott's talking about these memories of Pritis or his tackle. Life moves pretty quick. That's 18 years ago, and I still remember it like yesterday. And this could be the last time we see Benji play, and he's been playing since 03. I think he came off the bench against the Knights. And I don't know, like, there's going to be better players than him and immortals, but he's definitely a Hall of Famer. He changed the way people looked, the kids in particular, in New Zealand and Australia, followed one particular player. I don't think anyone who's moved to another club would have the full support. So all West Tigers fans will be cheering Benji on Sunday. And you don't often get that for players that have left the club. He's universally loved. He stood the test of time. The numbers speak for themselves. Won a World Cup, won a premiership. He's done it all, but he's an old school player too. A stand-up guy. I just can't speak highly enough of him, and we're going to miss him. So I just wanted to call that out because he's a proud Kiwi. He's my only shame is we didn't really get to see him in a Warriors jersey. But as much as it pains me to say it, I think best thing he kind of did for his longevity was leaving the Tigers. They let him down. He did his best to keep the squad together, and I just want to wish him all the best. And ask Blake if he's got any memories of him, because I've got plenty, and I just wish him all the best for Sunday.
Yeah, mate. Obviously, I've got a lot. Some I can share, some I can't. But, you know, like off the field, he looked after me as a young kid coming through. Like I've mentioned, I've had plenty of drinks with Benji at his house and up at the pub, and we used to love a punt and go out on a Saturday night. But like Scotty said, he was at training. I've never seen someone who can out-drink you but then out-train you. And that's a trait that he has. That's off the field. And you come on the field, mate. He did more for me in my career than a majority of players have done. You know, there's a few players, but he's probably the best I've ever played with, the way he's transformed himself into the flashy player now. You see him taking hit-ups in the middle, you know, just anything for the team. You know, I couldn't be where I am today, I don't think, without him. And like you said, mate, I reckon he goes down as New Zealand's greatest player. And there is no, I don't believe there's Roger or these players with the step if they're not out there watching Benji do it in 03, 04. So he's done more for this game than a lot of people might think, and especially in New Zealand. So go well, old fella. I'll be having a beer for you Sunday. I sent him a message on Friday night after the win, me having a beer. So, you know, I hope there's plenty more for him. I think it possibly is his last game. So enjoy. We all enjoy him playing, and what a career.
What a career.
It's been huge, not just at club level, but for the Kiwis as well. He actually, as you say, he fought and trained so hard that he forced his way back into the team after an absence of a few years. And that's pretty hard for someone who relies on that burst of speed, hand trickery. And after he did those sorts of things in the grand final, you could go down the parks and all the kids would be practicing that or trying it when they were playing a bit of park footy. So he's had a big, big impact on the game. And if this is his last game, well, he's done the sport proud, and wouldn't surprise to see me to see him. It looks like he'll probably head into broadcasting after this, the amount that we see him on the telly already. But I wouldn't mind seeing him in some sort of coaching role either. I'm sure he'd have a lot of knowledge that he could pass on to players coming through. So all the best this Sunday, Benji. Let's hope for another grand final medal. Right.
We know you're listening, Benji.
Should we get to some punting? Finally.
Yep. Yeah.
Let's get a best bet of the weekend. Blake, you lead us off.
All right, I've gone over to the UK. I've just tied it in with the grand final. I've got the Saints head-to-head, Catalans head-to-head, and the Rabbits plus 10.5. $2.16 you're getting for that, so not a bad price to double the money.
Fisky?
I love that. It's a great bet. Yeah, look, I think Scott was right, pretty much everything he said, but I'm just going to... I'm going to lean on this fresh legs theory, and Penrith may have played their GF last week. I just can't get enough of the Wayne Bennett factor and the energy shown by those South middle forwards and the stability they got in the halves. I just think they're just going better at this time of the year, probably since Origin. So I'm going to take South to win. They're $2.18. Full respect for Penrith, and I know I've been against them a couple of weeks now, so... yeah, I may have just got them wrong, but I'm going to go South to win here. 218, that's my best.
Cal?
I'm all in South this week, so I go plus 3.5 at $1.90.
Nice. I'll just mention the biggest price that Penrith got out to in the grand final winner book was $5.50. The biggest bet we've got left so far, there have been bigger bets that have been cashed out, but the biggest bet we've got left on Penrith, $2,750 at $3.75 to win the grand final. On the Rabbits, their biggest price this season was $12 to win the grand final. The biggest bet that we've got left there, $1,000 on the Rabbits to win the grand final at $9. And there are a couple of $1,000 bets on the Rabbits at $5 as well. So there's a wee bit more support with the bets that haven't been cashed out on the Bunnies.
Don't cash out. Stick solid. Don't cash out.
I'm with Carl here. I love the Bunnies plus 3.5 at $1.90. I just think, as you say, their legs will be a wee bit fresher after two back-to-back tough weekends for the Panthers. Add in the Wayne Bennett factor. He's already throwing sort of a diversion bomb over there by pointing out the, as Scott Sattler said, the Penrith Panthers trainer. Look over there. Next thing you know, the Bunnies are running away. So, yeah, I do like the Bunnies. Bunnies plus 3.5 at $1.90. Give us an anchor, will you, please, Blake? Anchor me in the
middle of your deep blue sea. Anchor me. I've gone for 8 minutes or later at the first try to be scored. It's $1.64. I think both these teams are pretty, good defensively. And I think it'll take a lot longer than 8 minutes for a try to be scored. So $1.64 you're getting for that. Not too bad.
Nice. Fisky?
Yeah, I'm just going to go Catalan Dragons, Friday morning at 7:45, $1.26. Throw that in your multis. That is not losing.
All right, Carl. Well, I know you've got a course that you need to be on very, very soon. So we'll go to you for your anchor.
Bunnies plus 6.5, $1.55.
Be quite nice. We'll go for you for a total.
Under 37.5. Grand final's going to be very, very tight.
We'll go a power play.
We've got a couple of power plays here, but I'll go Alex Johnson to score a try. And Blake, you'll like this in the first 10 minutes at $9.
Yeah, so 9 or 10 minutes. Yeah, yep. Sweet.
And a try scorer.
Alex Johnson, $2.
Good. And a Clive Churchill medal winner.
Cody Walker, $6.50. Get on.
Beauty. Thanks, Cal. Enjoy the course. We'll catch you again next time. I'll go back to Blake now for his.
See you, Carl.
See you, Carl.
See you, Carl.
See you, boys.
Like I said, I think it won't be a high scoring game, so I've gone under 37.5. I think, obviously the tries will come hopefully later than the 8 minute mark, and not too many are scored. It's a tough game.
Fisky?
Yeah, I'm on that train of thought. I'm just going to tweak it a little bit. I think Penrith really haven't troubled the scorer much for a few weeks. And these games, I think I remember when South won it in 14, it was 6-6 for a long part of the game, and then South ended up scoring 5 late tries. So it can blow out late when a team gets on top and the crowd's going bananas. So I'm just going to go the Penrith unders, because if South do go away, that they might get over. So Penrith total points of 19.5. I'm going to take the under.
I'm also on the game, the game total under 37.5 at $1.85. I think this will be a fairly tight grand final where points will be at a premium, as we saw last week. The Panthers did struggle, and if Edwards is out and they have to rejuggle that back line, I think they'll just find it a wee bit harder to score points once again. Have you got a power play for us, you boys?
Yep. I've got Brian To'o, first try scorer, Cleary Clive Churchill medal at 26.
Oh, geez.
Yeah, I sort of double that down as my roughie. I think, I like Penrith in a close one this week. I think Brian To'o, he's a winger, first try scorer, and then, you know, halfbacks. I looked up, did a bit of research, you know, as I do. Clive Churchill medal. The backs usually win it, and out of 35 given, 10 have been to halfbacks. So, I mean, if Penrith are going to win, why not Cleary?
Yep. I looked at the last 20, and I saw that out of the last 20, 5 have gone to halfbacks, 4 to fullbacks, and 3 to 5/8. So, if you're in the 6, 7, or 1, you're a good chance of picking up the Clive Churchill. Have you got a power play for us, Fisky?
Mate, I think I've found a little error here. This is tremendous. So only those listening to the podcast, don't tell anyone. Any starting winger, so jerseys 2 and 5, so we can go AJ and To'o fall into that. Jerseys 2 and 5, any starting winger, first and second try scorer, $5. Sorry, scratch that. I thought it was first or second. It's first and. No, they've got to score the first two. Scratch that. I thought if he got two shots at it, it would be brilliant. So I love the left edges for both sides. So I'm going to go Alex Johnson, first, second, or third. So you get 3 shots at it. And South to win 13 plus, $12.
Oof.
You get 3 shots at it. I'd almost bank that he will be one of the first 3
yeah.
price scorers, and you just got to get South 13 plus and you get the $12. So that's my angle.
I'm going with Blake Taff to be the first, second, or third try scorer at $7. He really impressed me over the last few weeks. You know, he's had big shoes to fill, but he's really stepped up to the plate, and he doesn't look out of place in that South team. And he's going to feature in a couple of my other books, bets as well. I'm also going to take him to score a try at any time at 450. I think that he will feature a wee bit more prominently than he has in his last few games. And I think he'll be running off Cody Walker a couple of times, and he might just catch that Penrith Panthers defense on the hop. So I really do like him. Clive Churchill, a medal winner, please.
Try Blake. Scorer? Okay.
Oh, try scorer, yeah, sorry.
Try scorer. I've got a power play as well for my try scorer. There, Cody Walker's $11 to score first. If he does not score first and he scores any time, you get your money back. So it's refunded. So I just think, you know, I think he's going to score any time. Why not take the gamble and get Cody Walker at $11 to score first? So yeah, that's where I'm going with that.
He got a double last week. He scored against the Panthers the last time these two teams played. So yeah, he's in some hot form.
Yeah, I'm going to go the left side as well, but I'm just going to go the safe option of AJ at $2. Look, we picked Taff, AJ, and Cody. Like, you know, I wouldn't be surprised if all 3 score, but geez, they just keep pushing the envelope on that left side, and geez, they're hard to stop.
Right, now we've got a Clive Churchill winner from Blake.
Okay, so 30 years since Penrith won the 91 title. And that year, it went to a losing player. It went to Bradley Clyde in the losing. So, you know, I don't really do the statistics too much, but a lot's happened. 30 years, you know, I think that 30 years ago as well, that the Panthers team that won in 91 lost in 90. Now we fast forward. The Panthers lost last year. I think they're going to win this year, but I think that the Clive Churchill will go to Cameron Murray in a losing side. I think that Penrith win the game by one, but it goes to Cameron Murray in a losing team.
Oh, you're talking parallels. I love it when you talk parallels here, Blake. Sensational.
I think Cherry Evans won in 13 as well in a losing side. There's a couple of precedents now. So Murray and Yeo are both $11. So I love the angle. So to win a Clive Churchill, you've got to be a rep player. Both these players were in the New South Wales squad this year. Primarily, you want to be a half, but eight of the last 20 have been forwards. So they fall into a bit of the same boat in that they're forwards, but they're ball-playing forwards that play for 80. So you're going to get a lot of ball in their hands. I think Yeo has just been phenomenal all year, really, but he was great last week. They're going to be prominent. They're going to be, without a shadow of a doubt, even both of them, I think will both be in the top five of the count. I see a bit of luck to go their way. So I'm going to take both at $11, which gives you $5.50 that Murray or Yeo will win the Clive Churchill. I just love how they're playing, and they tick a lot of boxes.
I'll just mention it that I looked at the last 20 Clive Churchill winners, not one centre in there, Blake, unfortunately, not one centre.
We're sort of, mate, the hard workers. Like on this
the
show,
workhorses.
I'm the hard worker. I don't get the limelight. You know, we just take the tough carries.
Beautiful. Oh, look, we've had a couple of big bets on the Clive Churchill winner market. 2,000 on Nathan Cleary at $4. There's a $1,000 bet on Nathan Cleary at $6.50 as well. I think that was before the preliminary finals. And we've had a $200 bet on Benji at $67. I think that's from an M. Fisk. I'm pretty sure it is.
Mate, I'll tell you what I did. I backed Brandon Smith last week. So not only did they lose, he got injured as well. So I should get double back for that.
Right, I'm going a wee bit wider than you boys for the Clive Churchill win. I'm going with Blake Taff at $34. Look, if Reynolds has got a wee bit of a dodgy leg again, Taff will be taking the goal kicks for the Bunnies. I also think that the Panthers will probably target either Taff or on the other wing. Is it Jackson?
Paulo.
So I think it's a mistake to try and target Taff because I think he'll handle the high ball with no problems whatsoever. And I do see him being a lot more involved on the offensive side as well. So it's been a funny year it's been a strange year with COVID. So I'm just going a wee bit leery with Blake Taff at 34 to be the Clive Churchill medal winner. I think that's it. It's been a long show, but it's been well worth it with our very special guest, Scott Sattler. He was absolutely fantastic. We'll have him back again sometime next season for sure. But thank you, boys, for being a part of the Grand Final preview show. And I'm sure we'll be back next week to go over all the money that we've won with our bets on the Grand Final. Thanks for joining us. This has been another edition of the Advatange Line. We'll see you again soon.